I'm Mills Kelly. I'm a professor in the Department of History and Art History at George Mason University. Well, I think we're largely locked into Blackboard and other learning management systems, largely because of institutional inertia on that. It's too easy for institutions to default to the big providers because those providers, they provide service. And most faculty members don't have the time to grapple with open source tools. So I think that's what we're going to see the most of. On the other hand, I think we'll continue to see a large growth in open source applications because there's so many people who want to do things their own way as part of being a faculty member. So one of the key lessons I work with my students on is falls into the category of digital forensics. They have to start to source digital materials in the same way we teach them to source analog materials, but they don't know how to do that. And so we go to whois.com and we do domain lookups and read the registration information and then do link checks and figure out who owns this website and what other websites do they own and what authority do they have to put this material up. Are they an expert on the subject or are they a hobbyist? And so it's the same kinds of questions that we ask about analog sources from the archives, but they don't have the knowledge of how to do that with digital materials. And they don't learn it in high school. They just don't learn it. And so if they're going to be good consumers of digital content, they have to know these things. So that's always the first place I start. I think that students are, and I wrote this in my book, I think that students are very adept users of technology, which is entirely different from being adept learners with technology. And so if we just say, well, just ask your students, because they know how to do that, that may be really good advice if it's how to use a particular software package that you don't know how to use. That's different from teaching them how to learn with digital materials and to think critically about the ways that a software package or something else can be deployed to do either the creation of historical knowledge or the analysis of historical information. So to me, that's kind of abdicating our responsibility as faculty members. Yeah, so I think that's actually a really great question because I do think that different people in the technological world come to the same kinds of problems that we have with different mindsets, different ways of thinking about these kinds of problems. And it's really useful to think about the tension between the way that as historians we think about the question and somebody who's a hacker or a coder or something thinks about that kind of information. Years ago, somebody I talked to at Princeton said that, in talking to a computer scientist there, they had completely different ways of representing knowledge. And they asked some very similar questions, but the way that they presented it was very different, and the way they valued that presentation was very different. And so they had some really interesting conversations about how they bridged that gap between their meaning-making. And so that's one of the things I work with my students on, is to say that lots of people come to these kinds of questions in very different ways, and so it's the space between those ways of thinking that's really interesting. It's not the results, and so in some cases it's not the result of the thinking, it's the space between the ways of thinking that's really interesting, and that's what we need to spend some time on. And in thinking about the way that other people think, you learn some really useful things. An article that I found just recently published in a journal of chemistry education, so not a journal that we read, and it's about how heuristics that students bring to the study of chemistry make it really difficult for them to understand basics in chemistry education and this kind of work that chemists do. And the list of heuristics that these researchers came up with, there were, I don't know, 8 different heuristics that made it hard to understand chemistry. And I think 6 of those make it hard to understand history. That article I found really useful for my own thinking about teaching, but I used it with my doctoral students this past year. And I think it was really one of the best articles that I've read about teaching and learning in years. The one thing I'm going to take away from the conference that is brand new to me is actually a teaching idea that I got in the panel that I was just in from Richard Bond at Virginia Wesleyan. And he has his students in the study of American religious history, he has them create their own religion. The short version is create a cult. But the key to what works in that assignment is the way that it's, they don't just create something for fun, they do it as a way of understanding a basic text in American religious history. And so they create something and then some sort of fictive religion, and in the period of the 19th century great, or second great awakening, and they have to say how what they did relates to the main points in this work, of complicated work of historical scholarship. And I thought that was just a really great way of approaching something like that. So now I have to figure out how I could do something similar.